Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Ham Nation is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This episode of Ham Nation is brought to you by ICOM. For more information, visit ICOMAmerica.com/hamnation and by DX Engineering. DX Engineering offers practically everything you need to outfit your shack, plus the fastest shipping in the industry. In-stock items ship the same day, Monday through Friday, until 10 p.m. Eastern. For more information, visit DXEngineering.com/hamnation. This is Ham Nation, episode number 254 for June 29th, 2016. Field Day Recap.
Good evening, everybody. You have your old computer or your phones or whatever tuned to Ham Nation. And it's a program where we talk about ham radio. And boy, have we got lots of ham radio tonight. We just went through one of the biggest exercises that all of ham radio does each year, Field Day. It checks our systems to see how we can make things work out in the field with no power. And we'll get into this in a little bit, and got some other things. So let's see who all's with us tonight. We'll go around the horn real quickly. We got Gordo out in Costa Mesa. How are you, Gordo?
I am fine, and we all survived Field Day and news to follow. Back to you, Bob.
All right. Don, how are you doing down in Mississippi? You okay?
Yeah, I'm good. So far, I've kept the vermin away from my spark plug wires for a couple of weeks now, and I haven't had to wrench on the car. And I'm doing good, and we're almost to the end of the nominating period for the Amateur Radio Newsline Young Ham of the Year Award. We've got some good nominees in, but there's still about 30 hours or so left. Midnight June 30th is the cutoff date. So you still have a few hours. We've got more on that and a whole lot more in Amateur Radio Newsline coming up in just a little bit, Bob.
Okay. George is here, but we'll come back to him in a minute. But look who's with us. It's Dale. Hi, Dale. It's nice to see you. Everything going okay?
Good to see you, and good to see Gordo, and good to see Don. Yeah, it's good to be back. It was a pretty long siege there during the month of May. And I think we're on the mend. We survived about 6 hours of shooting Field Day things on Friday and on Saturday, and then about as many hours editing on Sunday and Monday. So we're ready to go. I think we tried to capture the essence of Field Day and the importance of it and the reason we do Field Day. And you'll see that in the video segment, Bob. Go ahead.
That's great. I know you got a lot coming up. We have a lot to do tonight. It's probably going to be long, but be a good show. Before we start, I can't go on without letting you hear and see this letter. I got the sweetest letter that was written to all of us. I hope you can see some of this. I'll read it to you. Dear Bob, K9EID, I would like to thank you and the guys for putting on a great show, Ham Nation. I watch the shows every Wednesday night. My name is Joe. I am 11 years of age, and I live in northern New Jersey. I was introduced to ham radio 2 years ago by my grandpa, W3TTY. Ever since then, I've loved ham radio. I've been showing my friends my radio and telling them all about ham radio. I do not have my license yet. I am studying hard, though. I am thinking I could take the exam this summer. At the moment, I am listening. Catch this, everybody. I am listening to a Hallicrafters model S38C from the 50s. Say hi to the crew, Don, George, Gordon, and all of them for me. 73's Joe Greco. Now,
wow.
Is that or
That's
what?
That's great.
Joe, awesome.
Joe.
Oh, man.
Welcome.
You know, kids are the lifeblood of this hobby. And Joe, man, that's awesome. Thanks for the letter and congratulations on finding this hobby and I'm glad that we could be a little tiny bit of that, and awesome for your grandpa there too. That's just great. Love that.
It's just cool. He made his own own little stationery. He put a sticker of the St. Louis Arch in St. Louis from Missouri.
That's awesome. And that made my
down
day.
Below. He signed it. Yeah, it did me too, Don. That's why I figured I got to read this tonight. Yeah. I don't care what he says. That's the most important thing that's happened all week. It was really fun. But it doesn't take much to get me excited, but that really excites me because it takes me back to those days. And I'm sure each one of us, we really enjoy. And thanks, Joe. But I received a video and... I want to play this for you. It's a field day video from my friend Ken Graff. Ken is he's sightless, and he's the president of the club. Now, you think about this a minute. You know, we talk about things and do things, and not doesn't bother Ken, not in the least. And I just wanted to play this for you. It's another part of field day that a lot of clubs miss. You need to have that PR. You've got to have public relations. Get your club, get ham radio out in front of people that don't know what we do. And here's a perfect example. So if you could roll that, Brian, I'll appreciate it.
Whiskey 8 Hotel Papa, your 3 Alpha, Tennessee.
Ham radio operators across the country have participated in Field Day since 1933. At the event, thousands of people nationwide use Morse code and digital communications. It sharpens and showcases their emergency skills. Ham radios are useful because they operate without internet. So in emergencies, if cell phone service is down, ham radios work.
Ham radios there, they're not reliant on the internet. They're actually antennas that we've made that can be put up in a quick amount of time. And we can actually be communicating and talk to state agencies and help aid with hospitals, things of that nature.
At the end of field day, everyone participating will submit all the contacts they've made in 24 hours. Here in Bristol, they've reached places across the globe.
Okay, thank you for 2 Alpha Quebec.
People of all ages and abilities can learn this hobby. The Bristol Amateur Radio Club president is visually impaired. Still, he's loved this activity for 40 years.
I love it because I love contesting, what we call it, radio sport.
Graff uses Morse code and a computer software that talks to him to help him type.
I don't have to ask for a whole lot of help unless I mess up something in the program.
Ham radio isn't only about the skill and communication. It's also about the people you meet along the way.
I'll go to different conventions and meet folks from England or the Isle of Man, for instance, that I've talked to, and you get to put a name with a face, and it's really neat to kind of hear about their cultures and how they live every day.
Getting the facts right in Bristol, Jessica Griffith, News 5, WCYB.
And here are some fast facts. Last year, more than 35,000...
Oh, that's great.
Well, I just wanted to let you see some of the stuff that happens, and you can do this with your own club. You've got to have the PR. It's just TV stations are looking for information like this. So when you do any kind of event, that's the first thing you want to do is do a press release. You can do that. Go up on the internet and say, how do I do a press release? Because you got to have things of what is it, where is it, all that, time, location. And if you have a really formal and professional-looking press release, TV stations will pay attention to that. Their news directors are looking, and so that's what makes it happen. So that's the story from here. To answer a bunch of questions, it's my premiere night for the wonderful PR77. I've been working on this project for about 2 years, and we finally did the first run. It was a short run, and we'll see how everything works out. HRO bought that first run. I think a few of the other dealers might have it, but it's a copy, a retro, and a really nicely done of the old RCA mic that Johnny Carson had on his desk for years, and Larry King, so on. But it's our large dynamic, like we use in the PR35, that so many artists. We had a new artist this year, Miranda Lambert, just found out. She threw out her Telefunkens and her Shures, and guess what? We're blessed, but the microphone performs. So let's keep going here because we got a lot of good stuff tonight. And let's go see what all Gordo did for field day. This ought to be good. Gordo, take her away.
We had a great time at field day, pounded a little brass. And, of course, we had the DX Engineering non-skid pad to keep our keyer in place. We had battery power with the Biennio battery packs that lasted all 24 hours. Let's take a look and see some of the shots that others have sent in for CQ field day. And we first head to Oregon, and that is where actually Washington Pacific County Amateur Radio Club, they do their field day in the water. Now, you're wondering, how did they get that antenna in the water? Well, the water came to them. And it's a vertical using salt water as a ground plane. Russell, KB6YAF, Debbie and Bella were there to make sure that the tide came in. And that is in Willapa Bay, Washington. And John, KG7VDX, and Mark, K7MHC, with Jim Clancy, KG7DHO, ran the verticals and had the station really humming. So up in the Pacific Northwest, thank you, Russell. They were making things happen. That's what it looked like when the tide came up and after the tide went back down. But there they have huge tides. Now, this is a drive over the wheel mount, very, very effective from the disaster guy. And that's the Rust bus that he brings to Quartz Fest. And you just drive over there and bingo, you've got a big mass. Now, Russ sent in a few more shots here of operating on the 706 from the dash of the bus. And there's one of our operators on the air. Good job of log keeping, always important for field day. And the Rust bus had all the cool things like a comet dipole antenna up nice and high. And that is the horse fence, electric horse fence, electrified by radio waves. Gives a nice broad response on, looks like 40 meters, maybe 75 meters. But come to Quartz Fest next January, and you'll see all this and the Rust bus plus Debbie and Bella tuned in and turned out. But wow, what a great way to get on to field day from the Pacific Northwest. Well, now we go to the ABCDs, Arnie, Bob, Chip, and Dino. And this is the November 6th Hotel California Field Day. Look at that tower, 110 feet tall. They were up at 1,000 feet, and they had a signal that you just could not believe all over the area. And that's what it takes to put field day together, and that is putting it in your front yard, getting that all on the vehicle and driving at least an hour in heavy traffic to get to the spot. There's Dino, KX6D, Ham Radio Field Day this way. And wow, old rivals get together. And this is just terrific. So good that you have fun on field day. And of course, the GOTA station, well, they had the goat. I don't see the A, but well, it was like GOTA. And of course, field day had to have a safety officer, and Bill was helping there. So if you're thinking about antennas and you heard November 6th, Hotel California, wow, look at what they had. And those are fishing poles where Chip actually wound the wire around them. And 40 meters, two element, full size. And for calling CQ, omnidirectional, 50 megahertz omni loops, those were stacked and they had a great signal. They worked two dozen satellite comms. I only worked a few. Wow, this is amazing. And of course, Southern California, we got solar and loads of solar. That's Bill, W1HIJ. That's the Mars Man Coast Guard Auxiliary, making sure everything's safe. Thank you, Chip, K7JA. He really lit up the 6-meter band when the band finally opened on Sunday. And that's MC the Cat, making sure that everything is going to be put away nice and neat. And field day for November 6th, Hotel Charlie was a big success. Well, now let's go up to the San Bernardino Public Works Ham Radio Club. They're up at 6,200 feet, and they had kids on the air, and, you know, that's what makes field day fun. We have great operators like this, either at the GOTA station, and many of the kids were licensed. And we'll go on to the next shot. And at 6,200, their main bands were, of course, 2 meters and 440. Because look at that elevation. Look at that tropo. Hawaii is coming in today. And there's a field day manager having a great time in the shade. Then the Citrus Belt Amateur Radio Club just down the way in San Bernardino lit off its field day station. And look at that. They've got all the equipment. They got a nice case for that one set of equipment on the far end. And they were on the air at nighttime. No shortage of being able to see things thanks to light emitting diodes. And of course, you got to look at the back of these rigs to see what's going on. But thanks to Tracy, WA6ERA. Of the Mountaintop Amateur Radio Association, getting these photos of the San Bernardino Public Works, as well as the Citrus Belt Amateur Radio Club. All right, now we go back to the Pacific Northwest, to the Mariston Island, and this is from Bill, KL7 Bravo Bravo. Bill's the one last week we showed you build up all those neat little CW Keir kits, and those kits were on the air in Puget Sound, Washington. Wow, look at the tides. And when the tide comes in, the bands really go long. K7 LED is in a 20-meter bunker up on one of the bluffs overlooking the blue Pacific Northwest waters. And here they are doing those kits that we talked about last week, and they put them on 7.0475. They had to make a little crystal change because one of the stations was slightly off frequency, but a quick swap out of the crystal, and they were back on the air. Finally, from the Midwest, Don N9ZGE, a regular Quartz Fest attendee and presenter, shows digital. And there is his vertical. He's got a nice wet lawn, and he's got the radios all laid out. And Don was running the ICOM 7200 and the SCS PT2 USB digital converter, a modest little station doing all digital WinLink. And he was also working with a mesh network. So let me tell you, we so much appreciate those of you that are going digital on field day, because digital is such an important part of staying in touch via ham radio. So thank you all for these great field day shots. We're going to have my field day next week, as well as Dan, who's got a great field day shot before and after the major rainstorm. And again, congratulations to those of you that made this weekend happen. As Bob was saying, get the publicity out there and you'll make it happen. And I know that there was plenty of publicity because I was reading about it in many different newspapers. So good work, everyone, for Field Day. Only 363 days away. Now let's tune in to Don. And Don, what'd you do for field day? Did you feed some of those alligators some marshmallows, or what happened? Over?
No. They're waiting on you to come back down here. It's been, it's been 15, 16 years, because Tyler was just a baby when you were here last. So you need to come back down. No, I did not. We have one picture of my field day activities. And it involves some old timey radio and some. See, I've got my 807 right there, and you can see I got a rubber ducky, so I was on the handheld back there too. And of course, you know, trying to stay cool, I made sure that, you know, I was water cooled. I was very efficient with my field day. That was after I mowed the lawn and did everything else. It was hot, and all I wanted to do was get in the water. I didn't even turn a radio on for field day. I'm almost embarrassed to say, unfortunately. But it was a busy weekend. My niece's 21st birthday, in fact, was on Sunday, so we did some stuff for her that day. And sadly, she was not feeling well, so that day ended early. But nonetheless, I hope everybody else had a very, very active field day. And we're going to try to do that again next year. Get back on the radio. I mean, that's what we're going to try to do. Why don't we go ahead and get into the news of the week right now from Amateur Radio Newsline. From Amateur Radio Newsline Report number 2017, these are the Ham Nation headlines for Wednesday, June 29th, 2016. Deadly New Mexico wildfire spurred evacuations and prompted activation of local amateur radio emergency service volunteers.
The Doghead Fire that began its deadly sweep on Tuesday, June 14th, through more than 16,000 acres northwest of Tajik, New Mexico, was still only marginally contained by the start of the week beginning Monday, June 20th. as evacuation centers for both people and their pets were established in Barnelio and Torrance counties, nearly 1,000 New Mexico responders stepped in. Aries teams were activated in Valencia and Torrance counties, with Sandoval County Aries placed on standby. Meanwhile, the fire continued its deadly progression, and blasting record heat pressed down upon states in the desert southwest region. Fire officials said efforts to contain the wildfires were being complicated by the excessive temperatures. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Bobby Best, WX4ALA.
Major upheaval has shaken the ARRL's national traffic system just a day after a key ARRL committee praised the NTS for its valued public service contribution. Jim Dameron, NATMW, has more.
The league's executive committee has removed the system's Eastern Area Chair, Joe Ames, W3JY, who has also been relieved of his position as Eastern Pennsylvania Section Manager. His ousting became effective immediately. According to the ARRL website, the executive committee determined that Ames acted on behalf of the NTS and ARRL without authority to do so, and had made commitments to FEMA violating ARRL field organization rules and regulations, which state that NTS communication with FEMA should happen only through authorized ARRL representatives. Ames' removal was announced barely 24 hours after the league's Programs and Services Committee asked the ARRL board to recognize the NTS for its public service role, calling its members, quote, the lifeblood of this important ARRL program, end quote.
On Independence Weekend, the New England Patriots won't have an MVP at Gillette Stadium, but a group of hams might.
Seats at the stadium's 50-yard line are often coveted spots because they offer the best view of the action. But there's another reason for all eyes to be on the 50 at Gillette Stadium in Foxborough, Massachusetts, this coming Independence Day weekend. The kickoff on July 3rd will be a benefit run for one mission. The Pediatric Cancer Foundation, based in Framingham, Massachusetts, both a 5K and 10K event will step off that evening with the 50-yard line as the finish line. Hams are needed to bring their HTs and monitor runners' safety as the athletes tackle both the football field and the various ramps throughout the stadium itself. To sign up, contact Brett Smith of the Boston Amateur Radio Club at pubserv@brettcsmith.org. Once the event is over, there'll be a fireworks display at 9 p.m. just right for celebrating our nation's freedom and perhaps one day, too, freedom from childhood cancers. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Neil Rapp, WB9VPG.
The latest news reports are saying that the North Korean government has given approval for Dom 3Z9DX to return for his long-anticipated operation from the world's most wanted DX spot.
The Polish DXer has apparently been authorized to operate from Papa 5 for as many as 5 days. Though there are not many details yet, he will apparently be working single sideband only, possibly 20, 15 or 10 meters. Dom had surprised the amateur world last December with an unannounced activation from North Korea on the 20th and 21st of December. Working mostly on 15 meters, he made 780 contacts during that operation, which was a demonstration for the North Korean officials. He had hoped to return in midwinter for a more formal planned activation, but that did not happen. And now apparently that's all about to change. More details as we learn them. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Jason Daniels, VK2LAW.
Let's all cross our fingers on this one. And a very special thank you to all who have sent in nominations for the 2016 Bill Pasternak Amateur Radio Newsline Young Ham of the Year Award. Nominations officially close Thursday, June 30th at midnight, so you still have a few hours to send in your packet if you haven't done so. We look forward to seeing you Saturday, August 20th in Alabama at the Huntsville Hamfest for the presentation. And that's all from the Amateur Radio Newsline, your independent source for amateur radio news for over 38 years and counting at www.arnewsline.org. With Bobby Best, WX4ALA, Jim Dameron, NATMW, Neil Rapp, WB9VPG, Jason Daniels, VK2LAW, Karen Eve Murray, KD2GUT at the news desk in New York, and our news team across the globe, I'm Don Wellbanks, AE5DW. 7-3, we'll see you next time here on Ham Nation. All right, and we don't have a video from Dr. T tonight, but I did find something on her Twitter. This is the latest solar storm conditions in Aurora 5-day outlook. You can see we're the mid-latitude, so if you take a look at that,
That'll kind of give you an idea of maybe what you can expect. Some unsettled aurora possible, and 30% chance, so then a 5% chance of a minor storm coming up on Friday, July 1st. Looks like, so not sure how that's going to affect HF. Probably will be a little bit unsettled and may have probably about the same conditions we had for field day, because that was kind of in and out. So very good. So we look forward to having Dr. T back on just as soon as her schedule allows. And I think now we have some information from George about ICOM. Are we doing ICOM or are we bringing George
all stations
in?
The most popular on-air event is here. Field Day, June 25th and 26th. Make sure your ICOM equipment is ready for action.
Limited space, no problem.
The IC7100 base station is a great compact D-Star option. Angled control head and touchscreen for quick intuitive operation, large internal speaker for clear digital audio, and it's perfect for multi-bands and all-mode communications.
Be one of the first to experience
how ICOM is changing the way receivers are being designed with ICOM's new IC7300. It will exceed expectations. RF direct sampling, 15 discrete bandpass filters, large 4.3-inch color touchscreen, real-time spectrum scope, and SD memory card slot.
The sky's no limit.
With IC9100, the versatile all-around transceiver, multi-band, multi-mode, independent dual receivers, satellite mode operation, optional D-Star DV mode with the UT121, and USB connector for PC control. Visit icomamerica.com/amateur for more information on ICOM's radios.
And you can tune in and enter to win after each episode of Ham Nation. Go to icomamerica.com/hamnation and register for some great swag prizes like T-shirts and hats. And while you're there, you could learn how you could win the monthly grand prize drawing for our new radio. And for June, you've got one more day to enter. It's the ICOM ID5100 dual band, dual watch, VHF-UHF transceiver with touchscreen, analog and D-Star, internal GPS, DV mode, and FM repeater list-up function, available Bluetooth unit and headset, Android app, and a lot more. So go to icomamerica.com/hamnation and register after this and each episode of Ham Nation. And I'm not going to be able to hang around for the rest of the show. I had something come up, but I do want to give away what I promised last week. And it's the MFJ 4422 DC voltmeter and ammeter. I had a winner on that. What the question was is, what are you doing for field day? And there was no wrong answer for it. Well, I got an answer from Matthew, KD9ERS, and he said, I'm going to my first ever field day. I'll be at the Peoria Area Amateur Radio Club's field day at the Peoria Riverfront Museum. And next month, we'll be returning to the museum for our contact with the International Space Station. Well, congratulations, Matthew. We're going to send you this MFJ 4422 volt ammeter. Great for your mobile or really for your portable rig as well. And for next week, I've got another prize I'm going to give away here. And this is going to be some of the DX Engineering coax. This is the DX Engineering RG8X with some of the custom DX Engineering crimp-on connectors. If you'd like to win that, then I'm going to ask that question again, except we're going to change the tense on it. What did you do for field day? Well, send your answer to me, hamnationcontest@gmail.com. And you could be next week's lucky winner. And we'll be back a little bit later in the show with a smoke and solder segment from K7AGE, our friend Randy. And I'll be back with you next week. So 7-3, and Dale, if you'll pick it up from here.
Okay, George. Well, thank you very much. Enjoyed the information there and your contest. And we'll jump right in here this evening. Tonight, on Ham Nation, it's all about field day. We all survived, I guess. We've titled our video for this evening, Elmers and Emergency Communications. It's all about practice and training new operators. If we don't do that, we won't be able to respond when there is a real emergency in our local areas. Let's check out the Greater Wichita Area Field Day. It was hosted this year by the Wichita Amateur Radio Club. Now, hopefully, we've captured the essence of Field Day 2016. Amateur radio operators from around Wichita and surrounding communities poured into the Pawnee Prairie Nature Center like bees in a hive for the ARRL Field Day 2016. The event was all about Elmers and emergency communications. The challenges of operating in the field presented much opportunity for teaching and for learning. Sponsoring the Wichita Amateur Radio Field Day was a first for the Wichita Amateur Radio Club. The job had always been done by the Bears or the Boeing Employees Amateur Radio Club. This means it was a first also for Field Day Chairman David Rayson, KD0BGH. How did he get the job?
To me, it's an important event, and with that, I had an organization that went with me. I'm president of the Wichita Amateur Radio Club, and with that came up and said, I said, I will do this, and I said, go ahead.
For David, Field Day presented an opportunity to Elmer.
We've got a few of us that's done, you know, several years of this, but in this group this year, we've got a whole bunch of people that have done it maybe one time and some that have not done it before. And so we've got a lot of people to step forward and doing things that it's their first time.
And what did these newbies expect? Elizabeth K0LME is the club secretary, but it's also her first year as a ham.
From the operating standpoint, I look forward to just being able to play on the radio and get more experience and practice and to have fun in the process with others that have done it for years.
And what did the sophomores expect? Gary Thompson, K0BQB, was participating in his second field day.
I build a go box. I love the remote operation. So I build a go box, and I'll be working phone on it with my buddy pole.
Gary's buddy pole was easy to assemble, but what did he think about the 40-foot portable mast supporting the club's main antennas?
Well, this is my second year doing it, and that is a challenge. It takes a lot of people to do it, and you have to get all of the guidelines. There's three. And there's a dozen guidelines, and they have to be just right before you put it up or you end up toppling the 40-foot mast.
And what did his Elmer John, N0UBQ, think about that operation?
Trying to put up a 40-foot military mast kit that has seen better days, and it's kind of wobbly and bent in a few places and kind of goes up like a snake, and trying to get enough people out there to help put it up. I kind of said that kit was designed for 19-year-old soldiers, not Elmers, as it was. But we got it up, and it's it'll definitely last through this field day.
Yet, after the antennas are assembled, there's even more to learn.
Well, it's always a good opportunity to show, you know, the gist of field day, setting up a station from scratch out in the field. We put up antennas today, and we're dealing with all the issues of that and the field feed line into the building. And tomorrow we're going to be showing several newbies that how to set up the station in here, what we need to do for the grounding, and in this case, the logging for multiple stations and operations.
To help make it all happen, Club Vice President Jared
KD0MAC, served as a one-man IT department.
For field day, I played a part in with setting a, getting everything lined up for the network so we can have everyone in on one logging system so we can keep things all recorded in one place so things don't have to be combined later on. And this allows us to be able to view everything in one snapshot in one place on a map so we know what all states we've contacted and which ones we haven't. And we can also look at the scorecard to where we can see the different sections we've gotten to.
In the meantime, some of the newbies also came prepared to teach. Here's Wayne, KD0WAT.
I'm a new ham. I plan on setting up an antenna tomorrow all by myself. I'm going to do a triangulation from the center point using an expandable mast, and I'm going to have three guy lines holding it at about 16 feet above the ground. And I'm going to start out at the center point and measure out to one of the guy line stakes, and then I'm going to triangulate from there to a, to the next location. And I should be able to set this thing up without any help from anybody.
Wayne also plans to operate off of solar power.
Well, this is my first field day, so this is going to be an interesting setup. I plan on using an 817 radio, and I plan on just doing a demonstration of what the 817 can do. Hopefully we can make some calls. I don't know if we'll make any. It'll be interesting with just 5 watts of power.
Field day chairman David thinks the club just might be able to operate as Class 6A this year.
We have the potential of 5 stations right now being on the air, and also a possible 6th one. They're going to do some solar education for answer questions about solar, and they'll set up a radio station on solar for a while. And if we get enough contacts, they do, we'll be counting that also.
And what modes do they plan to use?
We'll be doing phone, CW, and digital in 20 meters, 40 meters predominantly. We might go to 80 at some time in the evening, and we're set up to do that. We can also, I think we might even do down to 10 or 15 meters. That has been locked in yet. I let my operators say what they want to do.
By Saturday afternoon, when the clock struck 1 o'clock Central Daylight Time, operate they did.
A5BDX, Whiskey Zero November, please copy our 6 Alpha Kansas, 6 Alpha Kilowatt Sierra.
Whiskey Zero November, Whiskey Zero November.
I copy 3 Foxtrot North Texas, QSL.
Whiskey Zero November.
Go. Whiskey Zero November. Whiskey Zero November.
Roger, thank you. N2, Mike, Mike.
CQ, CQ, CQ. Whiskey Zero November field days.
November 480 from Hotel Zulu. 1 Delta, Southern New Jersey.
USL, I copy 3 Alpha Michigan, 73.
One of the most important tasks at field day often goes unnoticed, but the ARRL recognizes the importance of public outreach and gives bonus points to clubs who carry out this important mission. The job for the Wichita Amateur Radio Club went to Joe, K0KFH.
Well, one of the things that sets field day apart from most other amateur radio activities is its public outreach. It's an opportunity for us to tell the story of what ham radio is and why it's important to a community. So the PR purpose is to invite the public, to have a proclamation from the city council, to try to get the public to come out and see the things that ham radio operators do so that they understand how we're ready to respond in an emergency.
So just how successful was the public outreach for Field Day 2016?
We have really been fortunate this year. We got a proclamation last week from the Wichita City Council recognizing this as Amateur Radio Week in Wichita, Kansas. And we got one of the council members, Council Member Janet Miller from District 6, to come out and tour our field day installation today, which of course gets us some bonus points in the scoring.
This is my first tour for the Wichita Amateur Radio Field Day, and it has been really interesting to come out to the park this year and to see all of the equipment, to see the individuals who are involved in this activity, and to learn about the different technologies they use to contact people not only here in the United States but around the world. It was a lot of fun to hear about how they use this technology for different kinds of local events, which are helpful to the events.
For the Wichita Amateur Radio Club, President and Field Day Chairman David Rayson summed up Field Day 2016.
If we don't practice setting up stations like this, when disaster happens, we won't be able to.
That's it for the video segment tonight. We're hoping to receive two or three video day video or field day videos from you in the next few weeks, our Ham Nation viewers. If so, we'll take a look at field day through your eyes. And don't stop with the videos. If you've got photos of your field day activity, we'd be glad to present some of that. If we get the videos and photos in, we'll present them on the July 13th. That's 2 weeks from now. And that edition of our video segment. And here's a quick reminder. Do send your shack photos and send videos about any of your activity out there in your club or anywhere else, any of your building activity, any of your operating activity, to hamnationvideos at twit.tv. And before you edit your videos, we'd appreciate it if you'd check out the guidelines for Ham Nation videos at hamnationvideos.info. Well, have a great Independence Day Monday. And let's not forget our neighbors and friends to the north. They'll be celebrating Canada Day Friday. So happy Canada Day and happy New Year, or happy 4th of July. And let's all have a good weekend. And if you go out in the sun, wear the sun blocker. Very, very important. That's part of the reason we've been missing for a while. So George is standing by now with smoke and solder. I believe he's got a great video from Randy K. 7AGE, but first we need to check in with Don, find out what's new at DX Engineering. Don, what's up?
Well, one of the things, thank you, sir. One of the things that's new is the Spring and Summer 2016 catalog. If you don't have this, you need to go to dxengineering.com and order it. They'll get it right in the mail to you. These things get thicker. Every new catalog gets a few more pages in it, and this one has 124 counting the back cover. So they get thicker every time they put out a new catalog, which means more cool stuff. All right, so we've got Field Day behind us. You brought your radio back into the house. Maybe it got a little dusty while you were out there. You know what happens? Mine gets dusty just sitting here in the shack, and DX Engineering can help you out with that. You spend a lot of money on this stuff. So E-Antenna makes really nice equipment covers for a lot of the many popular radio and even amplifier models that keep your equipment covered, will make your shack look cool while keeping the dust, debris, and other gunk off your expensive gear. And mine, sadly, is covered in dust, and I'm going to have to blow it off and maybe even blow it out. You do that periodically. These custom-fit covers are embroidered with the logo and model number of the gear they're protecting. And I've seen these in Tim Duffy's shack at the K3LR station, and they are really, really sweet-looking cover. Each cover has slits on the back, which means you can slip the cover over the radio or the amp without having to unplug any of the cables. They're available for select ICOM, Yaesu, Kenwood radios, and ACOM amplifiers. You can find yours at dxengineering.com. And you can stop chasing your CW key around your desk using those during those all-night contests and CW sessions with, in fact, Gordon showed it, the DX Engineering new paddle pad. It's a must-have if you're an enthusiastic CW operator. The pad sits under your key or paddle, keeps it from sliding around. They come in two sizes, one for the standard key size and then a smaller version that's great for a mini or a travel key. And are you working the national parks on the air stuff? You want to find maybe a better way to keep track of your NPOTA contacts? Check out the NPOTA National Parks site map from CQ Maps. It contains every national park on the air site in the country, including those in Puerto Rico, Guam, Saipan, and American Samoa. It's full color. It's easy to read. It measures 3 feet by 2 feet. You can see it from your desk. It looks really sharp up on your wall. It's made from heavyweight paper stock, and it's laminated, so you can use your grease markers on it. All kinds of cool stuff. Clocks, weather stations, QSL card organizers, a whole lot more in the station accessories section at dxengineering.com. And I've got a few of these. Look at that. This is my mouse pad. I've got a DX Engineering mouse pad. This is nice. It's nice. It's plastic covered. The mouse just skates over the top of it. Really, really nice. And of course, you may need to, you know, make random notes in your shack. So they've got the DX Engineering Note Cube. Yep, there's your Note Cube. And you can see I do use mine periodically. I try not to use it all up because, you know, it looks nice sitting up there where I can see it. And I've got my DX Engineering clock right there in front of me. You can't see it, but I can. And it's 24 hours, and I've got it set to UTC's time. So it's great. And they've got all kinds of cool station accessories in the station accessories section at dxengineering.com. And you know, DX Engineering ships faster than anybody else in the industry. If you get your order in by 10 p.m. Eastern, if it's in stock, it'll be on a truck headed your way tonight. Also, most orders over $99 are eligible for free standard shipping. Proven products, expert advice, DX Engineering helps you shrink the globe. Request your catalog. This one right here. Yeah, it's nice. Request your catalog. Shop online 24/7, 365 at dxengineering.com/hamnation. This is just an amazing catalog. You're going to want this. And DX Engineering, thanks for your support of Ham Nation. Hey, do you have a Go Box? Maybe you can put a DX Engineering sticker. Or you put that on the back of your car, maybe. And they got all kinds of nice things to spiff up your Go Box if you've got one. So just all kinds of cool stuff at dxengineering.com. And check it out, dxengineering.com/hamnation. Good stuff, good folks. You're going to love it. Now, George had to bail on us, but we do have Randy, K7AGE, through the magic of video, standing by with his field day video. So let's go ahead and roll that.
Hello, Randy, K7AGE at 1630. UTC from Charlie Nancy 72 up on our land here in Go Beach for field day. Got about an hour and a half before the event starts, so I need to set some things up. So watch along. So quick overview of what I'm going to be doing here. I'm going to be operating out of the truck. I'm going to put my bucket radio, my 857, on the console between the two front seats. And I'll set up so I can sit in the back seat and operate. I have a drive-on antenna pole mount, and I have about 24 feet of aluminum tubing that I bought from DX Engineering a few years ago. From there, I'm going to string up a 20-meter dipole and have a solar panel. I have my big roll-around 63-amp-hour battery pack and a fresh cup of coffee. Time to put on the sunblock. I have my 20-meter dipole and some cord wound up on this kite winder. Here's my homemade center insulator with a SO259, a socket, and a couple of thumb screws, so I'll just hook up the dipole to that now. I'm going to make a simple little choke ballon out of about 6 turns of coax here, just to kind of prevent any RF from coming back down the outside of the shield on the coax. So, got about 6 turns here, and I'll just tape it up. Okay, so the 857 is going to sit up here on the console, and that should make it kind of nice to use here in the back seat. And turn the power on. I got this little ASUS T100, a little portable Windows machine, and I'm going to run the N3FJP Scott's Field Day contest software. If you're not familiar with contest software, he has packages for basically every contest, and they're about $10, and they're really easy to use.
Now, 73, the other station, please.
K7
Kilo 7, Alpha Golf Echo.
Okay, I think it's Kilo 7, Alpha Golf Echo, 1 Bravo, Uniform Tango.
QSL, you have the call correct. You're my first one today. I'm also 1 Bravo, Oregon. 1 Bravo, Oregon. Thank you.
Okay, 7-3, good luck. Field
day, it works. Kilo 7, Alpha Golf Echo.
K7 Alpha Bravo, W7, WK7AB is something.
Kilo 7, Alpha Golf Echo.
Alpha Golf Echo, 1 Bravo, San Diego.
QSL, you're 1 Bravo, Oregon. Thank you. I stopped at the local market and picked myself up a sandwich before I came out here today, so I'll be eating good. It's part of field day. Kilo 7, Alpha Golf Echo. Kilo 7, Alpha Golf Echo.
Kilo 7, America, question mark, again.
Kilo 7, America, Golf Echo, America, Golf Echo.
Okay, that's what I heard. 2 Alpha Pacific to you, okay?
QSL, I am 1 Bravo, 1 Bravo, Oregon, Oregon.
Okay, QSL to Oregon there, my friend. Good luck with field day and aloha from Hawaii.
Aloha, thank you.
QSL, Kilo Hotel 6 Echo for field day.
Thank you, Whiskey 3 Atlantic Ocean.
Kilo 7 Alpha Golf Echo.
Kilo 7 Alpha Golf Echo, 17 Alpha Mike Delta Charlie.
QSL, you're 1 Bravo Oregon, 1 Bravo Oregon. Kilo 7, Alpha Golf Echo.
K7 AGE, 1 Echo, Georgia.
1 Bravo, Oregon, QSL.
AGE-73, November 4, Papa November.
Well, I think I'm going to wrap it up. I've been on the air about 4.5 hours. I got started about noon, a little bit late, but getting everything set up, as well as doing the video of everything, takes a bit of time. I work 33 stations. Furthest to the west was Hawaii. And I worked up and down the East Coast in Florida, so pretty much clear across the United States, down to Southern California, several Canadians and such. So had a good time, and we'll do it again. Had a lot of fun, and that's field day. My little 100 watts and a wire in the air worked just fine. 73, Randy, K7AGE.
Very nice. So good to have Randy back on. Good job, as always, Randy. And if you don't subscribe to Randy on YouTube, well, there's something wrong with you, and we don't want you in the ham shack. Go right now. Well, not right now, but after the show, and go to YouTube and subscribe to K7AGE. You're going to love his. He's been making videos forever and ever. And just classy guy, great videos. And we're lucky to have him part of Ham Nation. Okay, George had to run, so we don't have any info on George's contest. Maybe he'll do 2 next week. We shall see. But why don't we go ahead and jump to the chat room? We've got a few minutes now to talk to Valerie. Hello, Val. How are you?
I'm doing great. Hello, everybody. I'm filling in for Amanda this week. She's got some out-of-town relatives, so it's great to see all these field day videos and everything. We just finished ours, and boy, that kicked our butts because it was in the 90s and hundreds with the heat factor. So it was a pretty rough weekend for field day. But I got a lot of stuff going on in the chat room. First, I want to give a shout out to Francis, Alpha Foxtrot 7 Yankee Lima. She just upgraded from general to extra class. So congratulations, Francis.
Woo-hoo! All
right. Yeah. Got a couple questions. I'm not sure who's all in the house with us right now. What do we got? Gordo? All right. We got Gordo and Dale. And okay. First one, Kilo 4 Zulu Uniform. David in Virginia wants to know if any of you guys still run Packet. Anyone?
Yeah, Gordo does. I do a Packet with short messaging via the Kenwood APRS unit. So, yes, there is Packet activity in Southern Cal.
All right.
I haven't worked any Packet in a long time. I used to do a lot. I had a Kenwood TMD 700 that I used to run Packet on 2 meters a long, long, long time ago. I guess like Gordon, the last time I ran Packet was on APRS, but I haven't even done that in a long time. But it's still out there. And I know that the National Weather Service office in Slidell, Louisiana, the New Orleans office, they use Packet there to transfer information back and forth.
And there's not a whole lot of Packet activity, not a whole lot of activity here in South Central Kansas. There is an APRS node that's been up a while. We operated a lot of Packet back in the mid to late 90s. I ran three nodes and had one on 440 going up to Emporia, relaying down from Kansas City when we ran a bulletin board. But I haven't had any Packet activity, haven't actually participated there lately. It's all PSK 31 and 63 and all those other really neat new digital modes. So not a lot of Packet here in Kansas anymore.
Where did she go?
Uh-oh. Oh, my gosh.
She took a dive.
Earth to moon.
She probably unplugged something.
Oh, there we go. Back? Oh, man.
Is my microphone working?
Kind of.
All right. A message popped up.
Yeah. All right.
A packet message.
I'm not sure you're on the aisle. You may be on the camera.
Oh, am I? All right. Yeah, something happened here. All of a sudden, a note popped. This happened last week, too, or last time I was on. All right. Hopefully, you can hear me off the other microphone, off my camera. Kilo Delta 7 Yankee Victor George in Washington. Now he's in the fourth floor of his condo. He doesn't even get AM reception. He's got a Kenwood TS430 and an MFJ auto tuner, but there's no way to attach a solid ground. And he wants to know what he can do antenna wise. He's thinking the only thing he could do is drop a 100-foot wire out his window. Maybe Gordo, could help him come up with some kind of setup that would help him out living in the fourth floor of his condo.
Oh, yeah. Well, George, MFJ also makes an artificial ground. And once you get it tuned up for the band you're going to be putting the wire on, you'll be rolling with a ground side and a small little fishing pole and some little micro wire attached to the end of the fishing line. And a little weight, get it about 3 or 4 feet away from the side of your apartment building. And depending which side of the apartment building you're on, you're going to probably have some great DX. And who knows, get it 3 or 4 feet away, and you might even have a little bit of reflection gain on what would be a long wire antenna counterpoised by the MFJ artificial ground. So go for it. And if anybody wonders what's going on and knocks on your door, just reel it in, go to the door and say, are you seeing that fishing line coming down as I am? And they'll never know.
Very clever, very clever. Now, Dale, a lot of people in the chat room are asking if you're going to be accepting field day videos for the next week or two. So do they have to get them in within 2 weeks, or are you going to be running them, you think, a month from now as well?
Oh, no. Field day videos to Dale. Dale, why don't you tell him about the field day videos? And, yep, I'm loaded with short shots. So, Dale, take it away with that question.
Yeah, we sure will, Gordo. Glad to. In fact, we mentioned it there on the tail end of the video segment. I'll be on in 2 weeks. Val will be on next week. And then in 2 weeks, that will be the 13th of July. What we can do then is we'd like to run a lot of your field day videos. So if we get them in by, say, the middle of next week, not this week coming up, but the week after that, so that we've got that weekend before the 13th to put something together, we will sure get all the field day videos on we can. And the same goes with photos. Remember, if you do send photos, send some descriptive material with the photos. So we know what you want to say about them. If you're making videos, if we try to get 4 or 5 videos on, we'd need to make them about 2 to 2.5 minutes apiece. So if everybody does that, we could have a great segment with a lot of videos representing a lot of people around the country by doing it that way. So shoot for 2, 2.5 minutes to capitalize or capsulize rather your field day activities, and we'll sure get them on Ham Nation on the video segment for you in a couple of weeks. That would be 13 July. Val, go ahead.
And where should they send them to, Dale? Just a recap.
Oh, okay. No problem. We have a special email address at twit.tv. That would be hamnationvideos@twit.tv. They send them there. Just send a link to the video. They're usually on YouTube, but we get that link. We'll check it out and see how many we can fit in a 10-minute segment. So also, if you are planning on editing one, putting one together, figuring out how to capsulize it down and make it relatively short to summarize your activity in your area, check out Ham Nation Videos at, hamnationvideos.info, our Ham Nation Videos archival website, and there's some guidelines there that'll help you get your video on the air. Okay?
Very good. And that's all the questions I have. Sorry, Don, I don't have one for you. I feel bad. I could ask you, how many contacts did you make while you were in the pool for your field day? Just one to the wife to bring you a new beer, right?
No, she was working.
Oh,
she was working, okay. So I was left to my own devices, which may or may not ever be a good idea.
So. All right. Well, I got a few housekeeping things. We got the net on 14.268 for 20 meters. I guess it's a little rough in some areas, but hopefully you can still check into that one. D-Star Reflector 14C. And I think 40 meters was running around 7280. 7281, whatever it takes. Somewhere in there, but they said around, a lot of static.
7202.
We've been operating, operating down around 7180.
Oh,
I just noticed there's someone else on that frequency now. I'm waiting for Kevin, KC4FPF, to let me know where he's going to be, and then we'll be on there too. So
I saw 7202 in the chat room, so I'm pretty sure that's probably where they're going to be, right around there.
Well, we had to slide up. I noticed it was pretty busy down around 7180 just now.
Okay,
so.
Maybe I can't read my writing. Sorry. And that's all I've got for this week.
It comes in so fast and furious on the chat room, it's hard to keep track. Let's not forget the Echolink net also at the Dew Drop In. That's 355-800 is the node number. So there you go. Great job, everybody. Valerie, awesome job filling in for Amanda. We'll have her back next week. We miss George. Good to have Gordo in here. And, of course, always good to have Dr. Bob and good to have Dale in here as well. So I think we'll stick a fork in this one. I think we're just about done. We looks like you all had a good field day. We certainly hope you did. And hopefully the sunburn has started to calm down. You gotta bring that sunscreen. It's very important. So we will see all of you next week. Same bat time, same bat channel here for Ham Nation. So good night, everybody. 7-3.